good one is kazoo. But if an Italian sees it, the first thing you think of is cazzo, which, I'm sorry, it means dick, and we use it as fuck in Italian. So basically, if you wake up in the morning and you hit a table with your pinky, the first thing that you would say is aia cazzo. And if you looked at the jerseys one next to the other one, it was quite hilarious to see. But besides this, I was very, very impressed. I know you weren't, by Richarlison's performance. I know that Richarlison missed two open goal shots that he should have scored in, but he had 11 dribbles. He just has a lot of confidence. He can play with his teammates. He's got good vision. I think he's a key player for Everton.
I think that performance sums up Richarlison. He's very impressive, very talented player, can beat a man, creates plenty of chances, gets through on goal, but he doesn't quite have that composure yet. And I feel like once he gets that composure, that's when we'll see the real player. Again, it's a performance that kind of summed him up. But I think that's not where the main criticism should be for this game. I'm going to enjoy saying this, but Tottenham were absolutely terrible.
Yeah, Tottenham were lacking a bit of identity. James Ames, however you want to call him, was all over the place. And Tottenham just didn't seem to figure out a way to attack altogether, a game plan. There wasn't a game plan, basically.
Well, it was three impressive debuts from Decore, Alan, and James, and that's where the game was won. Tottenham's midfield was non-existent. Everton just walked through whenever they liked, and that's where the game was won on those three fantastic debuts. And once Everton scored that goal, it was in the 60th, 65th minute. You felt that the game was done. Yeah. There was no sign of fight. There was no sign of... And Everton could almost just sit back and go, okay, well, we'll just sit and wait now, and half an hour on the clock, we'll just take these points. I don't know, I was surprised by how bad Tottenham were, I'll be honest.
Well, good thing for Tottenham, they just signed Reguilón from Real Madrid.
A fantastic signing, I think.
It's actually a very good signing. He's a left back. He's just won the Europa League, and he's got quite some experience for being that young. He's played consistently in Madrid before moving to Sevilla. Then he's played for Sevilla an entire season, also in the Europa League. He's played the final. He's won it. I think he's got a great character, and the Spurs locker room is going to benefit from that. But also, who might be back at Tottenham?
My worst nightmare confirmed.
Say the name.
I do not want him back.
Say the name.
Because he was so good for them. But Gareth Bale, it looks like he's returning. Now, this is going to go one of two ways. This is either going to be exactly what they need, or it's going to be a repeat of golf, Wales, Spurs.
Wow.
It's going to go one of two ways. Now, I think when Gareth Bale has still played, he is still obviously an incredible world-class player. If his attitude is right, I think they've pulled off a hell of a coup here.
I think Real Madrid should be fined just for having Gareth Bale constantly sitting on the bench. I know he's not making it easy for them to be played.
It's six of one, half a dozen of the other at this point. I feel like Zidane hates him. I'm not quite sure why. It just kind of came from nowhere. And understandably, Bale has just gone, well, okay, if you're not going to play me, then I'll quite happily sit here and play golf. So I can see where he's coming from. I don't really see why they fell out or what happened. Without Bale, they don't get that Champions League win against Liverpool.
I think that the Bale situation is one of the most disrespectful situations out there concerning football players. I mean, Gareth Bale is a world-class player. I would kind of like to remind everybody that when he was at Tottenham, he was basically the only one playing football in that team, scoring goals, giving himself assists and whatnot. And then he went to Real Madrid and he's won everything. He's won everything a footballer can want to win. I mean, if you're from Wales, you're definitely not aiming at the World Cup, nor the Euros.
No.
He's won everything. He's won it all.
Well, I was doing a bit of research today, and I realized that he has scored more goals for Real Madrid than Ronaldo, El Fenomeno. And he has more assists for Real Madrid than David Beckham. Now, admittedly, he's played quite a few more games for Real Madrid than Beckham did, but I still think those statistics alone show you how key he has been to that team. And any final that they've reached since he's been there, he's scored. I think Real Madrid fans are spoiled. These are people who booed Cristiano Ronaldo. Like, I think they just did not appreciate him. And I think, Gareth, you're probably doing the right thing in getting out. I think it's probably a wise move. I just
go
wish
back home, Gareth.
Almost you were coming to Arsenal, but I know that was never going to happen.
Go back home, Gareth. We're waiting for you to join Tottenham again. And now, Rory, you've got quite a task. In one minute and 10 seconds, share all the excitement you have for Arsenal beating Fulham 3-0. Go.
Okay, so we have carried on some fantastic form from the end of last season. I know it's only Fulham, and Fulham looked awful, but apart from the wobble in the first 2 minutes where Maitland-Niles nearly scored an own goal, we looked so comfortable. You can see the coaching from Arteta is working, the patterns. Aubameyang's goal was a carbon copy of the goal from the Community Shield, including the disguised runs from Maitland-Niles. I think you can see that very quickly Arteta has transformed this team. If you look at where they were when Emery left, which was just the doldrums, the lowest point that club has been at, and you look at it now, honestly, we're going to Liverpool in a couple of weeks, and I'm not scared. I never thought I would say that. And I
am not scared.
Ready to be proven wrong, but I feel like at Anfield the last couple of years, it's been 5-1s, 4-0s. It's been embarrassing. At Chelsea, it's been the same. At United, it's been the same. Now I feel like we could go to away grounds, and I'm not thinking we're going to ship 4 or 5 goals. I'm thinking we could catch one, but with Aubameyang up front, for the next 3 years,
hey,
we are definitely going to score.
He signed the thing, didn't he?
I was in the bathroom when this news came through, and the cleaner was in the house at the same time, and I let out a little celebration, and I hesitate to think what she thought was going on, but I was very happy, very incredibly happy at that news. We've known it's going to be coming for a while. It's been all over Twitter, and I thought it would have been ruined, but no, it still feels just as good.
I'm so happy for you, Rory. Listeners, you should see Rory smile in this moment. It's so big and wide. So, also great debuts from Gabriel and Willian, who had 3 assists on his debut on an Arsenal shirt. But now it's time for our quiz, and this time I'm going to be hosting it. Rory, are you ready?
Andiamo, vai!
Hello, and welcome to our weekly quiz. So, the quiz this time is going to be slightly more difficult and slightly different from last time. Rory, you look in distress. What's that face?
I'm nervous.
You should be. Yeah. All right. So, basically, I'm going to talk in first person as if I was actually the player in question. And then, Rory and all of you listeners, you will have the entire second half of the show to think about the answer, and then you can see if you guessed at the very end of the show. Are you ready, Rory?
I think so.
Right, so I was born below the equator.
Okay, below the equator. Yep.
I've got 72 caps for my national team.
Impressive.
That's pretty decent. Thank you. I have played for 6 different European clubs in 2 different countries.
Okay.
Do you like these hints?
Yeah, nothing so far.
Well, among others, and this is an interesting part, I have played with a few talents and legends of the game.
Okay.
For example, Lilian Thuram, Laurent Blanc, Adrian Mutu, Roberto Mancini, John Terry, and David Beckham?
Okay, this is a... So the guy kind of straddled generations if he's got Mancini and Adrian Mutu and Terry, yeah.
And the guy, last tip, I mean, and I also won Serie A with 2 different teams.
Okay, right. Man, okay, listeners, I hope you're not shouting the answer at your phones because I've got nothing. So...
I had to get Rory back from last week.
Yeah. I feel like I laughed a bit too much and a bit too loud last week, eh?
But all right, very quickly, I was born below the equator. I have 72 caps, which is a lot for my national team. I have played for 6 different European clubs in 2 European countries. Teammates, Lilian Thuram, Laurent Blanc, Adrian Mutu, Roberto Mancini, John Terry, and David Beckham. What else? I have won 2 Serie A titles with 2 different teams.
Okay, let's go.
Let's move on with the next part of the show. We're going to talk about Serie A, and the answer will be back after that.
Andiamo, vai! Okay, welcome listeners to our weekly topic. So this week we will be previewing Serie A as it is ready to kick off this weekend. But quickly, before we start that, as of next week, we will be starting with our weekly topics, which will be chosen Each week, they'll be put on our Instagram or Twitter, and we'll be talking about different topics and aspects of the game, either history or issues that are in the sport now. It will be varied, and that is as of next week. So, without further ado...
Let's go, Serie A. I'm so ready to talk about it.
Let's get ready to talk about it. So, Tommy, you've been preparing all week. So, like we did last week, we're going to do some predictions. And we're going to start with, who do you think is going to lift the Scudetto next season?
So, I mean, you can only really say one team. I think that team is Juventus. And I hate to say that. They got nothing to lose. They literally have nothing to lose. They've won the Scudetto 9 years in a row. They've won it with three different managers now. Now they've got a fourth one incoming. He doesn't have as much experience as the other ones, but I think that this job at Juventus to win the league should be pretty straightforward, unless something big happens or unless they find teams like Inter that are actually willing to compete, because I feel like Inter last year, they lacked the tenacity that they needed in some given point moments of the season. Also, Juventus were among the few teams that were able to do transfer deals because they moved quickly enough. They moved very early in January by purchasing Kulusevski from Atalanta.
That was a very clever buy. Oh, very quick and very clever.
This guy, mark the name in case you're not familiar with Serie A.
He was unbelievable for Parma. Unbelievable.
Great player. Yeah. And also they have Artur from Barcelona. However, it was a swap pretty much with Pjanic. So it's not really somebody who is filling an empty position. And then, I mean, Suarez was in Perugia this morning in Italy to take his Italian test. So basically, Juventus have filled their quota of non-EU players coming in from outside the Serie A by signing Winston McKinney from Schalke 04. So now they need the Suarez to get an Italian passport if he wants to play for Juventus. But can you imagine Cristiano Ronaldo, Dybala and Suarez playing all together?
That is like a World 11 kind of dream team lineup. But I just wanted to go quickly back to something you said. The fact that Juve have now won it with three different managers 9 times in a row. They're giving Pirlo a chance of this new manager. When does this end? When does somebody else win this league?
Maybe this year? I hope so.
I hope so. Like, listen, stick with us. It's still a competitive league. It is a competitive league.
Also, I don't know about Pirlo as a coach, man. You've followed the story on Twitter, on Instagram. So basically, Pirlo had to do this, basically something comparable to a master thesis to become a level 3 certified UEFA coach or something like that. And basically, this master thesis that he wrote is now public. Everybody can read it. It's kind of confusing.
I've seen snippets of it on Twitter.
Some snippets are pretty funny. For example, our goal is to score goals and not to concede goals. That's pretty insane. And also, you reveal this lineup to pretty much anybody who wants to get into it.
Maybe it's just the ultimate confidence game. He's going to be like, look, I've given it you all and I'm still going to beat you. I don't know.
Even if he fails, though, let's remember that Pirlo is one of the greatest football players of our generation. So even if he fucks up badly, I will protect Pirlo.
This could be a topic for a podcast in the future, just Andrea Pirlo. I adore that man. His biography, if you're into reading sports biographies, you have to read Pirlo's biography. I believe it was written by him.
He had some assistance,
but a lot of it was some of the writing in it is absolutely beautiful. And he is a philosopher kind of on the pitch, right? I think when the news was announced that he was going to be Juventus manager, I was like a child at Christmas. I thought, this is exactly what I'm at. Like, this is what I want. A legend of the game, taking over a club and achieving things, even if it is Juventus.
But at the same time, one thing, if I was an AC Milan fan, I would be very angry at what's happening, all the talk around Pirlo, because they make it seem as if Pirlo is a Juventus legend.
That's a fair point.
Pirlo is not a Juventus legend. Pirlo has won some Scudettos with Juventus, of course. He had a key role in that team, I remember 1 year especially, but he's an AC Milan legend. He won 2 Champions Leagues with them.
That's a fair point.
He played the Champions League final with Juventus, but whoops, Juventus don't win Champions League finals.
They don't win
finals. So he didn't lift the trophy that one time. But yeah, I mean, a lot of the talk that is going on right now about Andrea Pirlo at Juventus, oh, it just makes so much sense because